Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Oakland Presbyterian Church. We're so glad that you are here. We have some old friends that are back. We have some family members visiting. We may have some first-timers. We're so glad that you are here. And real quick, a little bit of housekeeping before we move on into our worship service. If you have a smartphone, if you could take that out right now and point it at the QR code in front of you, that takes you to an app. And that has a lot of stuff that's for you to help you. But the main thing I wanted to point out is the connection card. If you don't mind filling that out on that app, that would be great. That's for both members and visitors. Tell us that you are here. Tell us a little bit about yourself. Then also, through that is our primary way of taking the offering today. Many people express their faith in Christ by giving as part of their worship. And if you have, if you do that, then the primary way we're doing that is online. And there is a link there on that app, safe and secure and touchless. However, if you brought your offering in hand, that's great. If you don't want to use your app, you don't have a phone, then we have a paper connection card that you can use. And you can take the card and your offering. You can put it in a drop box that we have back in the narthex when you came in. And there's one right over here. And I really, really, apart from all that, I want you to save a date. Very important in the life of this church. We are going to be celebrating our 135th year as Oakland Presbyterian Church. That's pretty exciting. Was anybody around back? No? Okay. Not even as a baby? No? Okay. Yeah, 1887 is when this church was organized, and we just feel like 135 is a good time to celebrate, and we want you to mark that date. Now, here's the important thing. We are only having one worship service that day, one service only. It's going to be at 10:30, so no early service, no 11 o'clock service. It's going to be 10:30, all of us together. And then following that is going to be a really, really fun potluck lunch. So you can be thinking about what you'd like to bring for that. Please plan on coming. Please plan on staying. We are having some special guests join us. I'm not going to tell you who. You're going to have to come to find out. But I think you'll just have a great, great day. So September 11th. Our actual anniversary is the Sunday prior, but that's also Labor Day weekend, and we thought maybe we wouldn't have enough people come to just make it as special as it could be, so we're going to do it on the 11th. So mark your calendars for that. Well, let's put all that stuff aside, and let's get to the business of worshiping our God and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I have some words that we can use right now to call ourselves to worship. They're in your bulletin. They'll also be up on the screen. So let's join together. Sing to the Lord a new song.
We sing a song of peace and hope.
Sing to the Lord a song of strength.
Our strength is in the Lord of hosts.
Sing to the Lord a song of joy.
Our song is a song of service and faithfulness.
Amen.
Thank you.
Worship isn't just a time for being filled with the goodness of God. It's also a time for emptying all the shame, all the regret, all the brokenness of the previous week. We can come, we can lay before the cross of our Savior Jesus Christ and receive grace, forgiveness, restoration. So let's do that now. I have a prayer that we all can pray together. Again, in your bulletin, it's going to be up on the screen as well. Then I'm going to give you a few moments for yourself to pray before the Lord, and then I'll bring us all back together with some good news. Let us pray together. God of healing mercies, we come to you this day as imperfect people. We know that you desire for us hope, happiness, and love, yet we have found so many ways in which to block your gifts or to grab hold of them as if we were entitled to them. But our service has mostly been for ourselves. Forgive us, O merciful God. Heal our wounded spirits. Turn us again to you, that we may again learn of your love and mercy. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. My friends, my brothers and sisters in Christ, hear the good news. God's forgiveness is real, and it frees you and I to turn again to the Lord, who always loves us. Because of the gift of grace from Jesus Christ through his cross, know that you are forgiven, know that you are restored, know that you are set free into newness of life by God's grace and peace. Be of good hope and cheer. Amen. And let's just pass that peace with each other that we have in God. Let's share it with each other. As many people as you can get to in 30 seconds. Share with them the peace of Christ. Thank you.
this time, I invite all the children to join me for Children's Church.
You thought I was going to children's church, didn't you? This morning's reading is recorded in the first chapter of Peter, chapter 2, verses 21 through 25. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Here ends the reading.
Way to go, Grover. Thanks, man. All right. I have a message for you today that has been one of the toughest messages I've ever had to prepare. Because I am not a doom and gloom kind of guy. I am somebody, hopefully you've realized this about me. Some of us have been together for a year now. Try to be very, very positive. But I just can't do that to start out this message. Because I really feel like it's important that we all know that it's a fact that the church in North America is in real trouble. It is in real serious trouble. The statistics alone, I mean, some of us have that feeling, but the statistics are pretty stark. They're impossible to ignore. They've been trending a certain way for enough time to say, yep, this is real. And indeed, it's accelerating. Just for an example, the number of people in the United States who identify themselves as Christian, that's dropping. It's dropping in relationship to population growth, which means that the church is not keeping up in terms of the level that it used to have. It is declining. Some of us, you know, we can see that with our own two eyes, but we might be surprised. It's declining in almost every way, in every denomination, in all sorts of groups and styles of Christianity. It is in decline in the United States. Our own denomination, the Presbyterian Church USA, last year lost 51,000 members. And we had a net loss of over 100 churches. Over 100 churches closed just last year. And I wish I could say that that's a blip, that's an anomaly. No, this has been going on for like 30 years in the Presbyterian Church. We have been in free fall. As long as I have been a part of a pastor in the Presbyterian Church, that's almost 30 years ago, the church has been declining. And now that I say that out loud, maybe it's because of me. Maybe it's my fault. Whew, that's a heavy burden. Okay, but I think it might be more than that. So we are experiencing, did you know, okay, we're in the South, right? The South, the Bible Belt. Everybody's a Christian in the South. Well, that's more true here than it is other places. But do you know what the largest religious group is in the South? In other words, most people in the South identify with this group. It is evangelical Christians. Okay, that may not be a surprise, but here's the shocker.
That group is evangelical Christians who don't identify with a church. They have no church. That is the largest group of Christians in the South. Those who are Christian, call themselves Christians, but they don't go to church. Lots of reasons for this. I'm not sure it's one big reason. Some people will point to scandals that have happened in the church, and there have been some high-profile scandals that we have seen even over the last couple of years involving prominent, very famous church leaders, churches, even whole denominations have been swept up in scandal. There has been abuse of power. There has been sexual misconduct. But the worst thing is there's been widespread cover-up in these churches and in these denominations about this stuff. They haven't been willing to be public and accountable about it. And that, of course, turns a lot of people off in terms of the Christian faith. But, you know, to me, the high-profile cases, really, they get a lot of press, but the bigger issue has been the low-profile ways that many people have come into churches, taken a look around, and go, nope, I'm just really not interested in this. I'm not interested in a place that seems to have hypocrisy. I'm not interested in a place that doesn't seem to care about each other. They're always going at each other. I'm not really interested in a place that doesn't seem to care for the people in its community, that doesn't have compassion for the people in its community. Even there's been a lot of folks that are just saying, I don't believe what the church believes. They put the Bible on a pedestal, and they get all sorts of information and facts that they say, this is what the Bible says, but that doesn't seem to jive with the character of Jesus. So more and more people are saying, I like Jesus, I'm a follower of Jesus, but I don't want to have anything to do with the church. The fastest growing group in North America, religious group, are those who are unaffiliated with any religion. That's the fastest growing group in the U.S. right now. Those who are not affiliated with any religion. But yet, there is one part of Christianity that is growing by leaps and bounds. Do you know what it is? They are just booming right now. So in the wake of traditional historic denominations like ours being in decline, that has opened the door for another type of Christian church to come in and kind of fill the void. That is the non-denominational churches, and we are seeing more mega churches being created now than ever before. So there's a bit of good news, right? Maybe this is offering some hope for the North American church. There's some renewal, there's some excitement, there's a lot of growth that's happening here. And true, there's a lot of good stuff that's happening in non-denominational churches. Woo, got it out. But the one thing that also is happening, and now they've been around long enough to begin to track what happens in these churches, and what they're finding out is these churches, non-denominational and mega churches, don't last long. They don't last long. Very few survive many years after their founding pastor or leader, charismatic leader, exits the scene. They very quickly start to dissipate, and they're gone within just a few years. I'll give you an example. There is a church in North America, here in the United States, that just inside 10 years ago, about 8-7 years ago, they had 13,000 people attending worship on average each week. 13,000 at one church. There was an additional 250,000 who were downloading the sermons every single week. This church had grown to the point where it had 15 satellite campuses in 4 different states, and they had started a church planting network that was doing work in 51 different countries. So most of us would say that and go, that's pretty exciting. That's an exciting church. They're doing some good things. They're planting churches. They're growing. That must be the way to go, is to do church like that. Guess what, though? That church I was just describing to you doesn't exist anymore. Inside of 10 years, actually, because of a scandal involving the founding pastor, that church was dissolved completely inside a year. And it doesn't exist. There's nothing left of that church. That's an incredible turnaround, to go from that height, getting so big so fast, to going to nothing. But here's the thing. Most churches, non-denominational churches that are being founded today, are following the exact same model which allowed that church to get so big so fast but have very little accountability for its leaders. They're just repeating the same model, most non-denominational churches today. And so what that leads us to believe is, while this is exciting right now, it's not sustainable. It's not going to last long, and after a while, people are just going to be frustrated with how these churches come and go so fast. There's nothing solid to them. So some of us are kind of going, those of us who remember, you know, what, six decades ago, the church was booming in the United States. Does anybody remember that, when everybody seemed to be going to a church? Churches across all denominations were growing. There was exciting kind of move into the suburbs, and it just seems like everybody was at least said they were a Christian. What happened? Some of us are wondering that for this church, right? Those of us who have been with this church for a decade, you can remember, more than a few decades, you can remember a time when these pews were pretty well full, and this is a great Sunday here. But as you can see, this church was built for more people. They assumed in those days that there were going to be more people going to church, and there's just not as many going to church anymore. What happened? Is there an answer? Well, if you read books on what's happened in the North American church, every single book is going to give you a different theory. But here's what I think has happened. This is Craig's view. I think what's happened in this time is that the church in North America has become more reliant on alternative sources of energy. I'm not talking about solar, but it's interesting, though. It is kind of the converse of the national conversation that we're trying to have anyway, about how can we become less reliant on fossil fuels, which are non-renewable, and how can we have a more diverse, and lots of alternative energy. That's what we feel like is important. At least that's what we're told. But for the church, it's different. We already have a constantly renewing energy source. We already have a power source that is adequate for us, more than adequate for us, no matter what we're doing, no matter where we are, no matter what pressures are surrounding us, no matter what influences are around us. We don't need any other source for our power and our energy as people to live life well than this one power source. We have it. But the problem is that the church has become enamored with alternative sources of power and has put its attention towards getting that power, maintaining that power, and protecting that power. What are some of the examples? What am I talking about? Alternative power sources. Political power. Social power. Cultural power. Being trendy. Or being countercultural, financial power, getting money, hanging on to money, moral power, being able to dictate what's right and what's wrong to everybody else. We have become enamored with these alternative sources of power in big ways, in small ways, in obvious ways, and not obvious ways. And so as a result, we are ignoring the fact that we already have all the strength and all the power and the energy that we need, and that's what comes from God. That's what comes from God. Bless you. I came across this quote this week that I thought just kind of summed it up so well. And this is one of those deals where I got a quote, by doing a search, and I wrote it down, and I exited out, and I tried to go back and find who said this, and I couldn't find it. So I'm hopeful I can find it and share it with you at another time. But Anonymous says this, but it seems to make sense. As Christians, we get our calling wrong. As Christians, we are getting it wrong if we imagine that God needs us to be the hero of our own story rather than Christ. For individual Christians, now let's do as a church. We as a church are getting it wrong when we imagine that God needs this church to be a hero rather than Christ being the hero that we point to in this church. We as Christians are beginning to believe, actually we've been believing this for a while, it's not beginning, that if the church is growing, it's because we are doing an awesome job and we've become relevant and we have become cultural and we're getting our music right, we're getting our preaching right, we're getting our programs right, we got our building right. If we're growing, it's because the success is ours. However, if we're not growing, if we're failing, then we still feel like it's something we need to fix. We need to figure this out so we can get growing again. We need more young couples. We need more young people in our program. We need to do this, do this, do this, do this. And God's going, wait a minute. I'm right here. So what's the answer? Is there a way that we can reclaim the power of the church right here in this place? And I believe it's going back to a foundational statement, three words, that the Christian church has been saying since day one. Way back Pentecost Sunday, we have been forming ourselves around this one foundational statement, three words: Jesus is Lord. That is the statement that brings us together and connects us to our power source. The fact that Jesus is Lord. Okay, this statement in Acts was not day one, but it was year one. This is what they were saying. This is what they were proclaiming out loud. The verse is next, if you don't mind, Travis. There it is. This is what they were saying right off the bat. Folks, you know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is what? Lord of what? All. Jesus is Lord. This verse that we're talking about today, 1 Peter chapter 2, that was read for us so well. Take a look at that. If you have your Bible, your digital phone, your paper Bible, whatever, we even have some out in the pews. That's what those are called, by the way, pews. That is a funny name, man. Can we just say that's a funny name? But if you look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, look at how he starts this author. He says, to this you were called. He's talking to Christians. And the first thing that he's saying is, this is a calling, folks. This isn't about you. It's about God calling out to you and inviting you in to what he is doing. Right off the bat, we're seeing that this isn't about us. If it was about us, we wouldn't say calling. We would say, this is our choice, in a sense. Or this is our decision. Okay, there was a faith choice in following the calling, but it begins with the calling. And then what are we called to? Well, this is what he says. We are called to see the example of Jesus. Do you see the word there, example? See the example of Jesus and then follow in Jesus' steps. Now, both of these words in the original Greek have a lot of oomph to them that doesn't quite translate into the English. So I'm going to share it with you now. If we're talking about this word example, what that means in the Greek is copycat. You are mimicking Jesus. What you're trying to do is when people are around you, they're around Jesus as best as you can. If we're a church in this community, then the expectation is that we are mimicking Jesus to the degree that people see Jesus when they hang out with us or when they come to worship. Take a look also at this word follow. In his steps, the word follow means to follow really, really closely. I mean to get right with the group and to stay with the group down the road, not follow at a safe distance. Man, if you're a disciple of Jesus Christ, you are right there with Jesus. Notice also what he says, skipping ahead to verse 25. He gives Jesus two titles. Do you see those? What are they? Yell them out when you see them. Shepherd and overseer. Shepherd, we probably understand, these were those who were charged, who were responsible with the protection and the safety of the flock. And they were responsible for getting the flock to where it needed to go because the flock wasn't going to figure that out themselves. They were just going to stay in place and eat grass until there was no more grass and then die. The shepherd needs to get them to the place where there's more grass. The overseer is a term in biblical times which described the manager of the house, of the household, the person who is responsible for everyone in that household's well-being, safety, protection, and that all that they needed was available to them. So again, we see this writer, 1 Peter, saying that Jesus is the one who has taken responsibility for us. Do you believe it? Do you believe that Jesus has taken responsibility for you? And if so, do you act like it? Or do you still think that you have responsibility primarily for yourself? There's no one else that's going to take care of your life like you can. If you're a Christian, wrong. Couldn't be more wrong. Jesus has taken responsibility for our lives, and that's why we gladly proclaim Jesus is Lord. And that's one verse. I can give you hundreds of verses from the New Testament that say the exact same thing. Jesus is your Lord. Jesus calls the shots. Jesus is the one who gives power to you as an individual Christian and gives power to us as a church. It is the same now as it was 135 years ago when a bunch of people here in this little teeny town surrounded by fields and orchards decided to gather themselves together and petition the Presbytery of St. John's. That's what it was called at the time, St. John's Presbytery, that they would be chartered as Oakland Presbyterian Church. I wasn't there. I don't know what their motivation was, but the fact that it's gone 135 years makes me think that their motivation was to proclaim in this place, Jesus is Lord. That is what drove them, and that's what's supposed to be driving us now, right now. And so what I'm going to do over the next several weeks leading up to our big celebration, 135th celebration, is kind of trying to unpack what it means to say Jesus is Lord in our own lives and in this church. There are going to be some hard conversations, some tough conversations, because it may be that we come to the decision we're not doing that very well. We've gotten away from that. But that's okay. That's where the healing and the renewing can begin. What our prayer is, that now, just as 135 years ago, we can say that's who we are now, and that's what our future is going to be, maybe even more so. Gracious God, I pray that this phrase would occupy our collective minds as a church, me and everybody here, over the next several weeks. What does it mean, Lord, when you proclaim to us that Jesus is our Lord? What does that mean? What are the ways that we have been looking to alternative power sources? Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us. But also help us to see it so that we can return to you, our ultimate power source. All the ways that we as individuals and as a church have ignored you and your presence for the sake of chasing after other standards of success and power. Forgive us, Lord. And we're praying for renewal and restoration of this church. We can't control everything, but we can come alongside you as a church. And we can see change happen, and we can see renewal happen so that many, many lives are blessed. That's our goal, Lord. So we pray that your Holy Spirit would move in the midst of this church to bring that about. And Lord God, we pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Reminded of the story as the story that binds us together, that brings us into a communion instead of a group of individuals. That story when Jesus gathered his disciples together in an upper room in Jerusalem just before he was arrested, just before he went to the cross, and then 3 days later rose from the tomb. So as these things are beginning to happen, he gathered his disciples, and during the course of their meal, Jesus took the bread, and having blessed it, he broke it, but then he gave it to the disciples, and he said this, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup, pouring it out. He gave it to them, and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood for the forgiveness of all sin. Drink of it, all of you, in remembrance of me." And so now, today, when we gather, and we share the bread and we share the cup together in communion, we proclaim that Jesus is Lord. Jesus is our Savior. Jesus is our forgiver. Jesus is our leader. Jesus is our sustainer. All to the glory of God and for the blessing of God's world. And so we are reminded of Jesus' own words when he said, "I am the bread of life. All who come to me will never be hungry. All who believe in me shall never thirst." My friends, the bread of life broken for us. Thanks be to God. And then the words of Jesus when he said, "I am the vine. You are the branches. Cut off from me, you can do nothing. But if you abide in me and my words abide with you, you will bear much fruit." And so, my friends, the cup of salvation, the blood of Christ, which was shed for us and the forgiveness of sin. Thanks be to God. Maybe you came here today needing grace to know that you can be forgiven. Maybe you came here today needing compassion and understanding. Maybe you came here today needing care and help. Maybe you came here today just needing strength for the living of life to its fullest. The call comes to you, and it comes to all of us to see the example of Jesus and to follow in his steps, making him our shepherd and our overseer. I pray that all of us would either dedicate ourselves to that for the very first time today, or would rededicate ourselves to that again. Amen. Friends, I pray that you'll go with God's grace to enfold you, with the love of Jesus to uphold you, and the power and the strength of the Spirit to mold you and keep you in great joy. Have a great week. Amen.